I can sum up what I'm going to say in just one sentence, I would say that it's very tempting to locate the enemy outside. But it may also be worthwhile to look at ourselves, to look at the civil service, to look at the two communities, and maybe there are certain changes which are needed in all of us. And maybe the political party is taking advantage of our own biases, of our own inadequacies, and that is why the problem has become so complicated. Friends, ideally speaking, the civil service should be independent, should uphold constitutional values, should be pluralistic in its approach, etc., etc. But we all know it doesn't happen that way. And it's not only in the last 4 years. If you look at the record of last 30, 40 years, you will find that there are many reasons which makes the civil service succumb to political pressures. There is this viewpoint that government does not appreciate bold decisions, bold and independent decisions. We've all seen and read in the newspapers what happened to Durga Shakti Nagpal, what happened to Sanjeev Chaturvedi of the Forest Service. He was given Magsaysay Award for fighting corruption, but in the eyes of the people, he may be a hero, but in the eyes of the government, he was zero. And he has been shunted from place to place. We have also read about Rupa, the police officer, who tried to reduce corruption in the jails, and she was shunted out. So therefore, since I have been a teacher at the academy, where IS officers are trained for many years, I can say that they start their service with a lot of zeal, with a lot of missionary approach, with a lot of passion. But very soon, missionary approach becomes mercenary in nature, because they find that boldness doesn't pay. To give my own example, I was Joint Secretary in the Minorities Commission in 1983. And officially, I went to Meerut to look into the 1982 riots. And I was shocked to see how the police had behaved in that riot. They just went to Firoz building and started opening fire, killed a very large number of innocent women and children. And I recorded all this. I wrote a case study on this. And since I was officially, I had done this study officially, I circulated it to the Home Ministry. In a very short time, I got a very strong warning that, Mr. Saxena, you had no right to write like this. And I was called. I said, look, you can't continue as in the Minorities Commission. Either you go back to your home cadre, UP, or you accept Kala Pani. Kala Pani meant at that time go to Afghanistan. I said, hey, Afghanistan, I must learn Persian. So I said, no, I'm quite willing to go to Afghanistan. Unfortunately, my stay there was not very long. I was again called back after a year. So what I'm trying to say is that there are many examples where you'll find that the civil service has succumbed to political pressures because of their worry about career. Also, there are examples, there are reasons why they willingly collaborate or cooperate with the political masters. One of the reasons why, there are two important reasons why it happens. One is lack of professionalism. Because if you do not have professional knowledge, then you cannot uphold integrity. Then you have to succumb to political pressures. So lack of professionalism is one reason, and which is because officers are transferred very soon. And in fact, one police officer told me that ab to hafte hafte ke posting hoti hai, to hafta banate rehte hain. We all know what hafta banana means in the police language. The other important factor why this happens is that unlike other services, unlike the armed forces, in the All India services, IAS and IPS, almost everyone is promoted to the last, to the highest level. But the number of important posts are limited. So therefore, there is a cutthroat competition for getting important posts within the IAS. For instance, in UP today, there is one chief secretary, but there are 18 officers in the rank of chief secretary. So naturally, those who have got, who are chief secretary, getting the salary of chief secretary, but only secretary protocol or secretary Rajbhasha, they would be very happy to go to a politician and try to get a more important job. So therefore, unlike the army, armed forces, where retirement starts taking place very soon, that doesn't happen. And for good reasons, because of the pressure which the IAS exerts on the civil service, on the system, so they are able to get promotions. But this leads to a situation where you have this structure has become inverted pyramid, and too many posts at the top, but of which very few are important. So therefore, there is cutthroat competition, which leads to people going to politicians, and they accept whatever they say. So ultimately, if our political system is not pro-people, if it consists of criminals or corrupt people or accountable to mafia gangs, it is not very correct, rational to think that the civil service would continue to be change agents or full of enthusiasm or will take bold decisions. That may not happen. So that is one point I wanted to highlight, that in the civil service today, there is a trend which has been going on for the last 20, 30 years to align themselves with the political values of the government, which may be patronage oriented, clientele oriented, may not be public oriented, but that's how the civil service also changes. The other point I wanted to say here is that if you look at the last 20, 30 years, you'll find that the civil service, also the police, has not been very neutral or has not been very impartial in communal riots. And therefore, there is a strong prejudice inside the Hindu community, which exhibits itself during the riots. And often you will find that in the riots, those who get killed by the mob are Muslims, those who get killed by the police are Muslims, and those who are arrested and subjected to third degree methods, they are also Muslims. So therefore, this is not something with lynching, of course, is something new, but there is a continuation. And I would like to quote from a few inquiry committee reports, which shows that how biased the approach of the police was. This is from Bhagalpur riots in 1989. The commission held the police, the SP of that district, accountable and responsible for the riots. And I read out from the report of the commission. It says, "We would hold Dwivedi, the then superintendent of police Bhagalpur, wholly responsible for whatever happened before 24th October 1989, on 24th itself and after the 24th. his communal bias was fully demonstrated by his manner of arresting the Muslims and by not extending them adequate help to protect them. The manner in which the search was conducted was reminiscent of the searches in occupied Europe by the Nazis. From my own report Meerut in 1982, I had said, then suddenly the Jawans opened fire, their weapons aimed at the residents. At this point, the civil officers fled from the scene. More than 100 bodies were removed by the PSC. It is said that 450 houses were raided by the PSC, and each house had now at least one occupant who would live with a deformity for the rest of his life. After detailed inquiries, I was convinced that at least the killing of 80 innocent people by the PSC was not accounted for in the police reports. Now, this is something which is not known to many people. In the 1992 batch, when the Babri Masjid was demolished, December 1992, at the academy, the 1992 batch celebrated the whole event. There was a big a meeting of all the IS officers, 120 of them. They exchanged sweets and they celebrated the demolition of the Babri Masjid. So therefore you can imagine the kind of independence or secular mindedness that we should have and what is the reality. In fact, the Home Ministry's report, which is also not very well known, written in 2013, it says like this. There were serious allegations that the police remained passive on many occasions. In many instances, police remained idle while looting, arson, and murders were committed in their very presence. In certain cases, police were an active participant in the violent mob. So therefore, there are a large number of reports where that the fact that we are not very impartial or fair to minorities has been demonstrated in these reports. So we need to really see how to fight this prejudice. Now, if we only take a very political view, that it is the political parties which are creating that prejudice, that is historically and empirically not correct. Prejudice is very much inside us. It has been there for many, many decades or centuries. And we really need to study this and see how best to fight it. I have not seen any book or any article or any consultation with psychologists as to how this prejudice can be fought. I think there is time that we should accept that there is something wrong with all of us and how to make us more fair-minded and make more impartial. That is what I think we need to do. At the same time, we should also look at not only at the majority community, but also at the minority community. Now, I would like to just give one or two examples here. I met a RSS leader, and he was telling me what is their strategy to change the Hindu mindset or change the Hindu pattern of voting. He said that whenever we go to a village, we always take Mr. Modi's speeches, hum paanch humare pachis, aur Eid pe bijli milti hai, aur Diwali pe nahi milti, etc., etc. But we also take video clippings of Mr. Owaisi, Mr. Shahabuddin, and Mr. Azam Khan. So when Mr. Owaisi says that hum to Bharat Mata ki jai nahi kahenge, so I'm very sure when people hear this, all of them forget that they are unemployed or that their produce is not being sold, they all start voting for BJP. Then he said, look, I'm very grateful to people like Mr. Owesi, because it is because of him that we are able to mobilize and polarize the Hindu votes. And then he said, Owesi sahab ka ke paas ek vote nahi hai, unke paas ek lakh vote hai. Ek lakh vote jo hai, wo humko dilate hain. Ek aadmi ek lakh vote dilata hai humko. So therefore, this is the reality. Two more examples perhaps. I was part of the National Advisory Council under Mrs. Gandhi. And if you recall, in 1911 or 1912, a few years back, we drafted a communal violence bill. In that communal violence bill, we had said the definition of the group which would benefit from the communal violence bill, a group was defined as meaning only religious and linguistic minorities, scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. So therefore it meant that if there is an attack by Muslims on Hindus, then they will not get any benefit under the communal violence bill. So we sent this bill to the Home Ministry, and then, of course, there were TV discussions. In one of the discussions, I was defending the bill, and from the BJP, Mr. Rudy, who is now minister, he had come. So the discussion went on familiar lines. I quoted figures from Bhiwandi riots and other riots, and I showed them how Muslims have suffered in those riots, etc., etc. After the TV discussion, Mr. Rudy, when we were all having tea, Mr. Rudy said, Saxena sahab, aap is bill ko pass kara dijiye. Hum to isi ko election mein apna plank banayenge aur election jeet jayenge. So something which appeared to us as secular, as fair, how it is exploited for political purposes by the other people, that is again we need to see either we are helping the minorities or helping the BJP. That becomes an important question. Lastly, friends, now this is very, very controversial, but still I must say it. I was district magistrate, DM Aligarh in 1974 to 76. As you know, those who are familiar with Aligarh would know that in the Aligarh Muslim University, there were two groups. One was consisting of leftists, Professor Nurul Hasan and Irfan Habib and others. But by and large, the students and the teachers, they were not of that view. They were, you can call them conservative, you can call them normal. In our intelligence report, they were all described as communal. So according to intelligence reports, they were communal group, secular group. Mr. Bhaguna was our chief minister. And again, those who know that period, Mr. Bhaguna, him, Vatinandan Bhaguna, he was trying to get Pasmanda Muslims or the lower caste Muslims into Congress Party. So he was under this impression that I am favoring the leftist group. I'm not in touch with the other so-called communal group of the AME. So he called me for a discussion. And his point is valid. He said, look, you may not agree with what the other group feels, but you should also have communication with them, which I accepted. And I did have a lot of communication with the other group. Finally, friends, I would say that Indian Muslims suffer from three disadvantages. First of all, like other regional groups, like linguistic groups, they don't have the advantage of concentration. So therefore, they are not able to convert their cultural identity into political pressure group. The other disadvantage is that unlike regional groups, where there is consensus, political consensus, as to how to deal with regional plurality in India, we all accept that in order to make a Tamilian or Bengali feel like as an Indian, you do not have to threaten their identity as a Tamilian or as a Bengali. Let them feel Tamil. Let them feel Bengali. That's the only way they can also feel like being an Indian. So the plurality is accepted when it comes to language, when it comes to religion. But there is no consensus, political consensus, or social consensus as to how to deal with Muslim demands. So therefore, there is this disadvantage which the minority community has, that unlike regional groups, where there's both political consensus and social consensus that, okay, we will not ask for a common script. Although many might argue that common script is a very desirable idea, but no one talks about common script. So we accept plurality, we accept diversity, but we do not do so when it comes to minorities. So therefore, this is a very big, I thought, disadvantage which Muslims in India feel. Lack of political consensus as well as lack of social consensus, because of which we have, if you look at the Dalit reservation, there's political consensus but no social consensus. So yes, for regional groups, linguistic groups, yes, no for scheduled caste, but no for Muslims. That's how, if you have a matrix in which you are looking at political consensus as well as social consensus, you'll find that there's no as regards Muslims. So friends, problem is, as I said, I would sum up, problem is very complicated. And it would be worthwhile not to take a very short-term view of only last 4 years. We have to analyze it in the context of the last 30, 40 years, and also look at ourselves and how we can change ourselves. That, I think, is what I wanted to say. Thank you.